nothing ever came from a net anyway. My fly in your ear, and then it done flown away. Oh, that aggravation, can't you ever say? From the music, anyway, came into my life, ripped my blues away. Oh, that stereo is my best friend every day. Something always comes from the music. Going to your bones, and don't you feel that music is life? Well, I do. It's like blood ever flowing, but I pray to God that the music fills the cup. Hello. Well, it gets me off when I'm feeling down, and I cannot sleep when that music is around. A wise man once said, a wise man once told me, he said, when music is the one thing that surrounds you, you feel no pain. Anyway, yeah, anyway.
Good morning. It is really good to be with you. I'm Reverend DL. I'm this morning's worship partner. And I'd like to welcome you to Westminster Unitarian Universalist Church. I'm glad we're here together for this morning's service. So whether you're here on campus or joining us via Zoom or watching the service later in the week, I hope you feel the love of this community because it is good to be together. Please note that the service is being recorded, so don't say anything that you wouldn't want recorded. I'm really overjoyed to welcome my friend and co-conspirator, Jocelyn Foye, the co-founder and now the executive director of the Woman Project. We'll talk about what that is if you don't know it already. She's a Connecticut native, and she brings her artistic training and experience as a contemporary feminist sculptor and design professor into what has become known as artivism, a mix of art and activism, and that's become a movement of its own. Jocelyn was a recipient of the 2014 NEA and the City of Long Beach Art Grants, and also the prestigious Emerging Visual Artist Fellow with the California Community Foundation. Side note, we're both Long Beachers who met here, which is a little odd. She lived in California for 13 years before coming back to New England. Please welcome her. In a moment, we will light a chalice together. And if you're offsite, this is a good time to find your chalice and a lighting instrument. If you're new today and you'd like to budget and repairs to the heating system, you need both a quorum and heat, I'm told. Secondly, after service today, SEEJ will have a table set up to write letters to voters in key states to get out the vote. Please join that if you can, and they also need stamps, so they would welcome either stamp or monetary donations toward that end. Third, you are continuing your service to the community initiatives with a walk to end Alzheimer's and a No More Hunger walk. Please see Friday's e-blast or today's bulletin for more information. Lastly, but definitely not least, the board has issued new guidance around COVID and masking. Please find that information in today's bulletin. And with that, we light our chalice. The chalice is a symbol of our Unitarian Universalist faith, and our chalice lighting marks the beginning of our worship service. As I lit mine, I hope you have lit yours at home. And if you like, you can post in the chat the name of the street name where the chalice was lit. I invite you to join me in the reading of the chalice lighting, which is by the Reverend Julianne Lepp. We seek our place in the world and the answers to our hearts' deep questions. As we seek, may our hearts be open to unexpected answers. May the light of our chalice remind us that this is a community of warmth, of wisdom, and of welcoming multiple truths. Our opening words today come from the Reverend Dr. Hope Johnson. We are one. A diverse group of proudly kindreds is the spirit of this church, and service is our mission. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. Please be seated. So often the time for all ages is offered in the spirit of a story or a moral tale. So we're going to shift a little bit from that tradition today in keeping with the intentions of Rosh Hashanah, the Jewish New Year. Rosh Hashanah begins at evening, this evening at sundown. And we're going to spend some time this morning in that vein, choosing to create some intentions together. For Jewish people around the world, and I offer you this because I am Jewish, each new year is seen as an opportunity for a new creation. It's a time to refresh and recreate ourselves and our communities both. And it's a new opportunity to fulfill our hopes and dreams for a better world. And so with that in mind, I invite us all into a spirit of imagination and meditation. Feel free to lower your gaze or close your eyes if that would help. So take a deep breath with me. and try to find the restorative power of air and water in that breath. And let it out. And keep breathing. We must breathe to live. But our bodies also need water. Feel the air and the water flowing in and out of your body, like waves gently rolling. Take one more deep breath with me now. Now notice your feet on the floor. Feel your connection to this building, grounded in this earth, connecting us to each other and to those who have gathered here before us. Ancestors whose presence lingers in this sacred space. What dreams and what visions did they pursue here? Now imagine these ancestors calling on us to create a new community at the start of the new will we create? Ancient Hebrew tradition that says before the earth was created, the world was a wild ocean full of dangerous sea monsters. And some days our world feels like that wild ocean. We may feel like we're fighting against those sea monsters. But the waters are just as strong as those monsters. And that power runs in us and through us with every breath we take. So as we breathe, may we feel the rhythm of our breath, like the powerful waves crashing on the shores, turning and tumbling the largest boulders into the tiniest grains of sand. And as we breathe in, may we feel the power of the air and the water nourishing the cells of our bodies, giving us the power We enter now into a time for joys and sorrows. Each week we set aside some time to name those joys and those sorrows that are on our heart. Who is my joys and sorrows person for today? Oh, it's Camilla. Great.
Good morning. I forgot my script, so I'm just going to wing it. My name is Camila Bajakowski, and along with Sue Bolens and Rob DeLong, we are the Lay Pastoral Care Associates. And what that means is that, of course, Reverend Eric Cherry, our wonderful new interim minister, is available for pastoral care whenever anyone needs it. But if you want to talk to someone, call on the phone or just get together for coffee or whatever and just chat, then the three of us are available and we're more than happy to talk and meet with you. And our contact information is in the order of service as well as in the on the Westminster website. So, today's joys and sorrows.
I kept thinking about what to pray for today. I thought about Hurricane Fiona. I thought about the people uprising in Iran. I thought about Prince Edward Island that just got hit so badly. But I also thought about all the daily slings and arrows, all the ways that we get broken hearts and anxiety and fear and worry. So my invitation for today is that we use our collective energy and we all close our eyes in prayer, remembering that the world is always sending its love to us and we are always sending our love to the world. I invite us to be in a moment of silence together. And for all those that are seeking freedom in so many ways, politically, it just in so many ways, I invite us to stay seated.
Philanthropist, a manufacturing lover of nature, poetry, and music. He was instrumental in the founding of the Public Radio, which serves as the public radio station for Rhode Island and Southern New England. So we will now give and gratefully receive the morning offering. So full disclosure, I actually asked the worship committee more than once to let me collaborate with Jocelyn on worship this week. It's not often that one gets to co-create worship with a longtime friend and colleague. And shortly she'll talk to you of the Women Project and what led her there. But what she doesn't say and what I want to give her and the group and this movement credit for is the way it builds community. When I was serving UUCSC, the congregation in South County, at least at first, I was very new to Rhode Island. I moved there, again, from Southern California. There's a little bit of a cultural difference. And I didn't have any friends yet. And I haven't kind of found my own people. And I'm serving this community, and yet I feel very isolated. And the Women Project changed all that. And not just for me. My first involvement with them was an invitation to go to someone's house and make calls to Planned Parenthood. And to my surprise, the host, Jordan, one of the other founders of the Woman Project, she had made soup for all of us. And she fed us soup and she fed us bread and she made us feel at home. And this was, I would learn later, the pattern for this group. Somehow, even while doing the most amazing advocacy work, they built this huge web of people of connection and made everyone feel seen and heard and important. And again, the Women Project has offered venues and opportunities for communities and individuals to grow, for people to learn and engage. and for change to happen. And I could tell you so many stories, but I'd keep you here all morning. But instead, I'll say this. They reminded me of the power of just showing up at the State House and so many other places. They reminded me of my own power. They reminded me that I was not alone in my desire to create change. I know that some of you have been a collaborator with them already, and you know this, that you've experienced this firsthand. But with gratitude, right after a moment of music, I invite Jocelyn to share this with us.
Thank you so much for having me. My name is Jocelyn, and I go by the pronoun she, her. I'm a mom of two children, 12 and 9, and I'm not originally a Rhode Islander. I came through here in a very circuitous route, which has led to the way the Woman Project was formed. So I've become the executive director. And what that means is after 5 years of being a volunteer and doing it in between my day job, as well as being a parent and having a Girl Scout troop and running around sports things, we somehow built a movement of people like ourselves who fitted in and decided to hone in on activism and find a way to make change. And it worked in Rhode Island. So thank you, Rhode Island. We are, as an organization, a grassroots crew who merges art and activism. We merge policy shift with different creative ways to get to it. And I will explain that more with you, but we focus, because we're all volunteers, we focused on one piece of legislation at a time. And we focused on reproductive health in Rhode Island before it became a huge issue nationally. So, much of the work, though, that we do and that DL referred to and that I refer to later is called artivism, because I think it's a nice way to merge the idea of art and activism. I'm not sure, by the way, on a side note, if you do land acknowledgments here, but I want to acknowledge that this is a land of the Narragansett people, and we're appreciative for being able to be here. So I've been invited here to speak about this organization, which we call the Woman Project. It has an X in it to be acknowledging of anyone who identifies as non-binary or any form of difference in a gender, but that we focused on issues that were more dominantly focused on folks who are women and non-binary. And I co-founded it with four other people, but how the story of my path in creating it and building a movement with it and leading it is actually the story of expansion and contraction and the faith to keep moving forward in totally uncertain times. And I would expect that folks sitting in this room have that story, is very well known to themselves as well. The COVID time has given all of us a chance to reflect whether we liked it or not. And the world, as well as our perceptions of how we fit into it, has seemed to shift. As a white cis woman, I am lucky enough to say that I was able to hold a full-time job being a marketing director and designer while running the Woman Project to support my family, my organization, and the community at the same time doing this work. You see, up until 2 months ago, I was doing it, as I said before, for free for 5 years, and I'm now at a point where I'm able to do it full time, and actually it's supported for that, which is wonderful when you want to say that people should be paid for the work they do. So, but I came to this path of activism in a non-traditional way, and that's really more the story here, and I think that this is where we all can touch in, just different ways of applying the same story. if you had asked me where I saw myself going as a young person, my dad was a botanist. I always thought for sure I would be a scientist, but I started realizing that my brain thought differently about the world, and I saw things in visualization and in pictures, and I thought of communicating through those pictures. So I went to school and I became a sculptor, and I
to support my expensive art habit, as I often called it, but it really is it's paid off. And I ended up going to college and graduate school. And I was doing work in Los Angeles where I was doing sculptural projects that were spectacle based. Everything in Los Angeles was bright and shiny. Everything was loud and in your face. And I learned how to use that system of spectacle to apply it to different types of things. And so by coming back to Rhode Island, I was first a Connecticut kid, and then I moved to LA and I'm back. I have been able to apply that to activism, and as has the folks that I get to work with. And by the way, we are not an insular group. It is welcome to all, and everyone brings their own style to the group, which has made it what it is today, which is the warm, and it is it applies to different types of needs and interests, all with a focus on changing policy in Rhode Island to be better for women and non-binary folks. So my art practice led to my being a design professor, and intentionally I was using it as an excuse to come back to the East Coast so that I could get grandparent help, which was awesome. But I definitely had to woo my Southern California surfer. So we ended up in Rhode Island because this is where there were surf spots. It's amazing. What a privilege to be able to do that. But people often say, how did you get here? And we joke and say a spreadsheet, which is true. And as soon as 45 was elected, because I don't really like to say his name if I don't have to, I was a part of, to find community myself, I was a part of Hera Gallery in South Kingstown, which is the fifth oldest women-started arts collective in the United States, which is incredible that we have here in our state. I worked with some folks there to quickly pull together specialists who could talk to us about what, from their subject matter expertise, they expected the world might look like with this person running it. So the first person we invited was an immigration lawyer. The second person we invited was the ACLU executive director, Steve Brown. The third person was the head of policy at Planned Parenthood. And the fourth was the Coalition for Domestic Abuse, or against the domestic abuse. And so we had 15 speakers back to back come and really illustrate in Rhode Island what our situation was state level. And then they all expanded to the national. But I think what happened was, is a number of us in this group that were listening regularly got so overwhelmed with what we thought our expectations of policy were in Rhode Island and what they actually were. And so we said, well, let's pick something to work on together and take accountability for that work and see what we can do. So we decided and we landed on trying to fight for the codification of Roe in Rhode Island. This was meant that when Roe is now overturned, we in Rhode Island had on the legislative books that we would try abortion providers as murderers. I went to a conference and I was sitting next to some folks from Alabama, and they said, you know, Rhode Island and Alabama are not much different. And I sat there and I was like, huh, talk to me more about that. And they said, we both are run by the mob, and we both are going to try our abortion providers as murderers. I was like, I don't know everything that you're talking about. So I have things to learn. The mob part specifically. I knew about the other part. So what it meant was for 24 years before the Woman Project showed up, that fight had been happening in Rhode Island. There were a number of General Assembly members that were doing this incredible fight. And really what it was is that we had a dominant legislative body that said, sorry, this is never going to go anywhere. So when we showed up, we said, how do we change the conversation? How do we not make that possible for them to say no? So we started combining art and activism. We started showing up where people were instead of saying, you have to meet us at the state house. We said, let's go to an art center and start building things together and talking about it in these smaller groups. So to illustrate my point, one thing that was really successful was we created a quilt It was much like the model of the AIDS quilt that was displayed in Washington, D.C. and all over the world. But we did that and we called it the community petition quilt because each square on the quilt was signed by different community members. And we wanted to see that, we wanted to use the conversations we had inviting people to sign a quilt to be their own signatures of a petition. And so we worked with master quilters. Actually, at Deal's Church was the first sewing stitch. And so people were building these awesome quilt squares in 8x8 square sections. We put them on carabiners and they would attach to each other in these sections. And so as our conversations grew and as we went to more places around the state and more people made little quilt squares and the master quilters would take them home and build these phenomenal pieces, the quilt would grow and it would grow and it would grow. And it went to 2,500 signatures. And we would hang it in the state house from the third floor all the way down. And over time, the General Assembly members couldn't stop avoiding it. It became something. There it is. Look at that. So those are some of the sections. And so we took it to the top of the building and we hung it down and eventually it touched the floor and the security folks came to us and said, this is becoming a fire hazard. And we said, that's okay. It's going away really soon. Don't worry. So, and DL was a part, DL is standing there with myself. We went to Washington, D.C. The Center for Reproductive Rights asked us to come and bring the quilt. And they wanted us to bring it to our federal delegation to show them and ask them to sign the quilt. I mean, it was definitely a photo opportunity. Well, why not? So, and we were there also lobbying for the Women's Health Protection Act, which is actually the federal bill that is designed to codify Roe. So we hope to see that in the near future. Anyway, so this thing, this amazing object, offers a way for people to host, it offered people a way to host gatherings that were warm and inviting and not cold like the state house. And it sort of opened our eyes to the interests people had in being involved and just not in the normal way. We all have different ways that we perceive what it means to be an activist, and we wanted to layer in community a little bit differently. And so this approach, and I think it's important to say, embodied a playfulness. So while the issue was hard and heavy, the approach was the opposite. And you know what the other thing is this quilt has represented a change in Rhode Island, empowered moments that were built by these master quilters. And they embodied amazing, I mean, you think about the history of Rhode Island, we have an incredible history here of quilt making and the historic storytelling that they were used to speak to where people needed to hide or where people needed to honor the dead. And we bring it to the forefront where we are one of the most strong epicenters of design in the country. And you still have folks coming out of RISD and other types of community spaces that are creating these modern day quilts that redefine what quilt making is. So it was an object that I think has done very well for who Rhode Island is, and at the same time, site-specific installation art. Anyway, so we're honored that now this quilt is on display at the Pembroke Archive for Women and Non-Binary People, so that at any time any of you would like to, you can go and access it. That record is available for anyone to make an appointment, as I understand it, and you can ask for those records to be shown and they will take pieces out or the whole thing. And actually they just had an event. And so it is on display in their main library right now. So if you are in the Brown University campus area, you can go and walk in and not even have to talk to anyone about it. So this was one of our first artivist pieces that we built, and it taught us how Rhode Islanders wanted to be active, like I said before, why they wanted to be, and in what ways work for this particular state. We often hear from people all over the country like, oh, well, this really worked well here. And we often say surprisingly, well, it won't work here. Or we've done projections on buildings and people have called us and been like, that is so innovative. And we're like, well, that's been done for 50 years outside of Rhode Island, but maybe it's new for Rhode Island. And so thank you. You know, we'll keep using that as a tool. So we grew in confidence by learning what fit us and what fit the General Assembly's response to us. And I think that you could say that with this confidence and intensity, we never lost the playfulness and the approach that was hard at times because people wanted to downplay what we were doing and in the importance. But truthfully, when it all came together, it kept us grounded because we were able to say that we were grounded in this community built process. And that still works for us today. So we had things like, we had community design, we had art, we had musical instruments coming to the State House, we had ballerinas performing, we had zine makers, we had all these opportunities for people to come and just touch in different ways, because we always said the State House is the people's house. It's not a place where you shouldn't feel like you're welcome. So we learned how to also get people involved in the process and a little less demystifying of that space. So I'm wrapping up here, but a few things to say is that in general, people are scared of political action. I think a little less so than they used to be. I think everyone's sort of emboldened these days more than we've ever seen, but they're scared of political action because they think that it's writing and paper and it's about the power and the money and how things, then that's how things change. And I think that that's true to a degree, but I do revert back to, interestingly enough, Merriam-Webster, who defines politics as the art or science concerned with guiding or influencing government policy. And Woman Project is the movement of that art. We own that little piece of it and we say, okay, what can we do to push it more? We surprise people by dressing up in costumes. We've done that. That really took people by surprise. We created installations like this quilt with signatures, and we've had billboard trucks driving around the state that are moving images of inclusion and equalness. We find that the satire, the hypocrisy, even the stupidity, we show it back to Rhode Island in vivid imagery online or projected on buildings of power and history. And we've gotten responses back that we didn't expect because people have said, oh, we didn't think of it that way. So we ask ourselves, wow, what more could we do? Or how could we change that? The reality is when you use art and bright colors and pictures of just general people, it's hard to look away. I mean, we're all used to seeing screens everywhere and social media, so many pictures and stories and stats, but there are ways to make impressions, and we are finding that niche. We do try to make people care, and we found that we can. We gave our politicians the push to enact law that protects women and non-binary folks in 2019, and we passed it. That was codified in 2019 in Rhode Island, which was one of the few states in the nation to say before Roe was overturned that we were safe. And you know, we built this culture that invited and inspired so many activists to learn about the process of how to build becomes a law and how they can make change in that process. And a number of our volunteers have gone on to run for elected offices because they felt inspired by that process. So looking back, the story I wrote here is magical. I reread it this morning. I was like, huh, interesting. I put that word there. So, and I think about it because it's hard work. There's nothing easy about government processes, but it's magical in the people that were involved and how, and sort of the twists and turns and how it's easy to give up. And we didn't, and we kept fighting for something that we were told we wouldn't be able to succeed in. And we did it with tons of organizations across the state. The Woman Project brought, sometimes people say, the special sauce. We brought the uncertainty. We brought the, what sometimes is called the outside game, where there were unusual things that they weren't able to plan on and just made people keep talking about it. The bill ended up being called the Reproductive Privacy Act. And what it did is it made it so that abortion providers would not be tried as murderers, but it left out a number of people in that legislation. And that's where we play games on the backs of people who are much more socioeconomically challenged in our state. And so that's where the Woman Project is working now. And that's what we're fighting for. If you're familiar with the terminology, the bill in at the federal level is called the Hyde Amendment. The Hyde Amendment takes away government insurance to cover abortion. So any Medicaid recipients cannot have abortion provided in their insurance. Well, in Rhode Island, our state law also does not allow that for state workers as well. And so we asked ourselves after this bill was passed, we said to the community, what do you want to do now? And everyone came back to everyone, like 200 people came back to us and said, we want to make the right real for everyone. We don't want to have anyone left behind. And so I would argue that we're in a harder fight. We're a harder fight because we often say it's easy to play the games of saying, oh, it's this abortion bill. And we say, this isn't about abortion anymore. We passed that bill. The state decided that that was okay. What we're fighting for is equality of all people in Rhode Island. And that's a harder fight because it's messy, as we all know. We know some people will always say, well, I'm not racist or I'm not sexist. And it's harder to call people out on those kind of things. The bill is now called the Equality and Abortion Coverage Act. And we built a campaign coalition of 42 organizations. The Women's and Infants Hospital just signed on with us to be a partner. And so as a body of organizations, big and small, super intersectional bodies, we're asking ourselves the question of what do we need to do to get this across the finish line? And with the Dobbs decision happening this past June, that's what everyone wants to talk about at every level of government. That's all people want to talk about is abortion, sadly, but truthfully. And the Dobbs decision, let me just say, from my standpoint and my organization's standpoint, that was not about abortion either. It was about privacy rights. And so it opened the door. I mean, of course, they took away this piece, but it took away potential for so many other things, and it set a precedent of concern. So basically, the scientist in me knows that experimenting is good and normal. I go back to my story of the non-traditional path of how I got to this role, being a spectacle-based artist who loved including everyone, giving them a good show was a happy place for me, and it still is. Being somewhere between the serious and the play to invite many more people and voices to the table has been essential as well. And so while we do not know what the future holds, we take pride in knowing that it's worked in the past and we're going to continue trying to do it. And so in conclusion, I would just want to say we've utilized alternative means to bring issues of non-binary and women's issues to the state house in less than traditional ways, to keep the issues in politicians and state administrators' minds, as well as keeping the news company's attention, because that always helps us. They love the weird things to report on and we give it to them as much as we can. And it just keeps it in the news. We're like, okay, we'll use it. And our special sauce is that balance of activism through collectively focused play and community growth that will win these fights and lead us into a more just future. And you know, this sounds a little cheesy, but it's true. Join us if you'd like to, if you ever feel like you want to spend a half a day or something with us. We have all sorts of ways to play. Sometimes it's serious, sometimes it's writing, sometimes it's showing up places. But, you know, one of my friends showed up the other day and she's like, hey, I know a puppeteer and we're making giant puppets. And I was like, oh, okay. I don't know what that means. And the next thing I know is there were 7 Supreme Court justice puppets that were as tall as this. And they were all on heads on sticks, but they had these black shawls over the sticks. They looked like Dementors from the Harry Potter series. And she said to me, let's go and take some pictures in front of the Rhode Island Supreme Court. And I was like, yeah, let's do it. That sounds great. I don't even know. And so that is an example of how we bring certain flares and creativity and also an opportunity to have different ways of bringing these issues to the forefront. So join us at events or whatever you would like to do. It's an honor to be here with you and able to tell you our story. It's an honor to be able to tell you my way of how this growth has really created a community and also just the sustainability in that we have to figure out how, with all of the crazy and the difficult, to make there be play involved in it. So thank you so much for having me.
Please rise in body or spirit and join us in singing hymn number 318, We Would Be One. Thank you. Our closing words today are by Amanda Schuber. Looking at you here, Jocelyn. In honor of the risk takers, those that hold the vision with clarity and charge forward with optimism, even in the face of others' doubts. You are our lamplighters and our guides. May we never forget the courage it takes to lead the way forward. In honor of the skeptics, that might be me, those that gather the information needed to navigate the tumultuous waters of change. You are the map makers and the preparers of the stores. May we appreciate your attention to the details that keep us on course. In honor of the doubters, those that fear changing the tides of a turbulent world, you are our anchors and remind us of where we have been and where we are as a community now. May we relish your commitment to the history and your passion for who we have become. In honor of the dreamers, those that can imagine what we can be and they share this with the world, you are the wind that blows the sails of change, pushing us ever forward. May we revel always in your whimsy and your hope that dares us to never stop becoming. May we do the work together to strengthen our community and the world. May we heed the call to always hold the vision of the free church in our sight and to work towards justice. Together, we wield a powerful spirit that is strengthened by all of our gifts.